Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. It appears that we have reached an inflection point in the inexorable march of technology, my friends, and it is one that I've been waiting for a good while. We've got AI chatbots that feed us AI-derived text. We have AI still photo generation to produce titillating imagery for us to feast our eyes upon. But what about the next step in AI evolution? No, not the singularity when AI becomes self-aware and merges itself into an omniscient digital hybrid being capable of completely taking over world governments and the human race in general. That already happened in 2023. Media coverage was pretty light on it, actually. I'm talking about AI-generated video. And for more on this, we go live to our new field reporter, a corgi on the beach in Maui. Hello, hello, corgi. I'm just kidding. That corgi video was AI-generated with a simple prompt using OpenAI's new Sora model. And who knows, maybe my whole video is AI-generated too. Maybe this is AI-generated beer. What can you trust anymore? Probably not your eyes. But for now, I say we just roll with it and see how this plays out. Oh yeah, there was other PC hardware news this week too about CPUs and GPUs. I'll talk about that as well. But for now, computer, generate Paul's Hardware Tech News Show for February 18th, 2024.
Yeah, no problem, Paul.
I think it's working.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware Store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise. Tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. All right, let's finish covering Sora first, as revealed by OpenAI on Thursday. It's a diffusion model that can create videos up to a minute long with a simple text prompt, and the examples shown on their landing page are just absolutely stunning. It can also be used to extend existing videos, and while it's not perfect, as readily admitted by OpenAI, there are a handful of videos showing it spawning infinite wolf puppies, or conjuring up cursed plastic chairs at an archaeology site. The leap from previous models that could maybe animate a still image for a few seconds to this is quite remarkable. Sora is not available to the public yet, nor will it be available soon, according to an OpenAI spokesperson, but they are gathering early feedback and, let's call it like it is, flexing pretty boldly with the capabilities of their new model. Ethical and legal implications abound, of course, as governmental bodies and regulators attempt to keep pace with AI's rapid advancements. And in the US, at least, the FTC has finally proposed a rule to protect individuals from AI-based impersonation and fraud. They have already finalized a rule about impersonating the government and businesses, so it's nice that they're considering some protections for us actual people, too. Once AI video is perfected, though, and Sam Altman's generation here is coming pretty close, what will be next? Well, that would be AGI, or Artificial General Intelligence, and true AGI models would be able to recreate human ingenuity and come up with brand new solutions to problems, versus simply mimicking or recreating existing art or writing or photos or videos based on the data that they're trained on. And according to the most recent news from Amazon's AGI team, their work is also progressing and their model has shown emergent abilities, as in exhibiting language abilities that it was not trained on. And whether that makes you nervous or excited, you're probably right. Let's steer gently back towards PC hardware with NVIDIA's video posted Thursday showing off EOS, their AI supercomputer powered by 4,608 H100 GPUs, which makes it the 9th fastest supercomputer in terms of raw floating point power, but probably the fastest or one of the fastest for AI-specific tasks. Along with the H100s, there are 1,152 Intel Xeon Platinum 8480C 56-core processors, and nodes are connected with NVIDIA's Mellanox Quantum 2 InfiniBand technology that can hit transfer speeds up to 400 gigabits per second, which is very important for AI training purposes. No word on how much it will cost to rent the EOS supercomputer out, so you can make your own 16K resolution Corgi on a Beach videos with OpenAI's Sora model, but it will presumably be on the pricey side. The overall cost of EOS, based solely on the 4,608 H100 GPUs, which typically sell for $30,000 to $40,000 each, would be $140 to $190 million, and that's not including the Xeon Platinums, the building, the electrical and cooling bills, etc. What's even crazier is that this seems to be a cut-down version of EOS. NVIDIA says there will be multiple EOS supercomputers, and the specs they first revealed back in November 2023 listed 10,752 H100 GPUs, more than double what the supercomputer revealed Thursday has installed. But I suppose the price is probably worth it if you can just generate videos now without having to pay actors, directors, scriptwriters, videographers, and all those other inconvenient expenses that come along with content creation. Speaking of expensive things, NVIDIA GPUs. Sure, they cost a lot, but what if the cost was $10 less? That's the newsworthy bit of info written up by the folks at videocards.com. A $10 price drop on the RTX 4070 Super, now down to $590 for Zotac's Twin Edge model, and while it's a small savings, it is hopefully indicative of a continuing trend in the PC hardware space of video cards becoming more affordable over time rather than less so. And I will say that it is nice that this has happened within about a month or so of the original launch date. It's nice that the prices on Amazon and Newegg are still the same a couple days after this article went up, and that the cards are still in stock. And also notable that amongst the 40 Super cards that were announced, the 4070 Super was the most highly regarded in terms of performance per dollar, and the most affordable, relatively speaking. AMD's Radeon cards have also seen continuing price drops, with the 7900 XT holding steady at $700, and the 7800 XT now available for less than $500, with multiple cards at $490 after promo code. Small steps, yes, but they are steps in the right direction. Intel apparently has one more 14th gen CPU to launch, and as usual, it is the KS flagship model, a clock speed juiced variant of the 14900K, presumably built on binned silicon with an S added for good measure. These Halo tier CPUs aren't typically recommended for most builders since they fetch a price premium and often need to dramatically ramp up power draw to hit peak frequencies. And the 14900KS seems like it will continue that trend with an impressive 6.2 GHz peak turbo clock and a much less impressive 410 watt power draw, at least according to results from the OCCT benchmark database that were discovered and published by BenchLeaks. Even premium 360mm and 420mm all-in-one coolers struggle to keep up with the 14900K non-super, so you might want to consider a water chiller or moving your gaming setup to the frozen tundra of the Great White North if you're at all interested in upgrading to this CPU. No word on pricing either, but if rumors are true, it should be available for sale in mid-March. We save tech briefs for the end of the show because, let's face it, sometimes it's embarrassing to have them right out there on display for everyone. But if you're feeling self-conscious, never fear, because these stories are embarrassing for pretty much everyone involved. NVIDIA has been riding high on their CUDA platform for a long time, but at last, AMD Radeon users can get in on the action too, thanks to Zluda, which is available in open source format as of Monday and functions as a drop-in CUDA implementation, allowing you to run unmodified CUDA apps on Radeon GPUs. There's a bit of backstory, since Zluda started as an Intel project built on the Intel One API Level 0, LZ, ZL, Zluda, but the Intel dev for the project was contracted by AMD to continue it in 2022 after leaving Intel and adapt it for Radeon hardware. AMD has decided not to release the software themselves, but instead gave the dev a window to release it as open source, which was likely done to skirt legal repercussions, but the upshot is that it works on Windows and Linux. Benchmarks show good performance, even better than AMD's native ROCm solution for stuff like Blender, which is interesting. So if you have a Radeon GPU and you want to do CUDA stuff with it, head on over to GitHub and try out Zluda. AMD's Ryzen 8000 APUs are already out, but according to Twitter leaker Harukaze5719, they will have new 35-watt TDP versions available soon, too. That's 30 watts less than the likes of the 65-watt 8700G, with power saved primarily thanks to reduced clock speeds, which of course reduces performance. This info was revealed in the notes for some recent ASUS BIOS updates, and while there is likely a small subset of potential Ryzen 8000G APU buyers who would be interested in lower TDP versions, you should also keep in mind that these will probably be OEM only, so you'd need to buy a pre-built to get your hands on one. Microsoft is apparently embarrassed enough about people running Windows Windows on older hardware, that they're making requirements for the dubiously named Windows 24H2 even more stringent than before. And these won't be annoying requirements that can be worked around, it's a show-stopping error based on the hardware you're using. Popcunt isn't just shorthand for what percentage of Australia's population is composed of douchebags, it's actually short for the population count instruction. And if your CPU isn't compatible with specific SSE4 instruction sets, then Windows 24H2 will simply refuse to install. That means no new Windows for mid-2000s Intel Core 2 Duo-based PCs, as well as earlier Athlon 64 systems. Probably isn't that big of a deal, to be honest. On the flip side though, the update is also promising some functionally useful features like automatic super resolution, with AI enhancement, of course, which probably won't be the only AI-boosted thing that Windows integrates, but using upscaling to improve performance on older hardware, as long as it's not pre-mid-2000s CPUs, of course, and enhance the PC gaming experience in general, makes me cautiously optimistic about the potential for automatic super resolution. AMD's biggest embarrassment in 2023 was probably the rollout of Anti-Lag Plus, the driver-level latency reduction tool that triggered anti-cheat bans for quite a few gamers after its debut back in September. But according to AMD's Frank Azor, they will be bringing it back soon. Asterisk, but hopefully they won't be rushing it out this time. AMD did seem to take their time with Wednesday's disclosure of fixes for Zen-based CPU vulnerabilities, which includes 4 new ones, as well as cumulative updates for the dramatically named Zen Bleed vulnerabilities from 2023. The 4 newly discovered vulnerabilities require an AGESA microcode update to patch, and for the bulk of consumer AM4 CPUs, that is now version 1.2.0c. So it is good that there are fixes out now, but it is also up to your motherboard's manufacturer to issue a BIOS update that includes the new AGESA code, and support for some aging 300, 400, and even 500 series AM4 boards is lagging behind. So you should update your BIOS if you can. And if you can't, then you should compose a strongly worded letter to your motherboard manufacturer telling them to get on the ball, issue some newly updated BIOSes. Intel was embarrassed this week too by the Spec Group, who called out Team Blue and bulk canceled 2,600 sets of benchmark results achieved using their software suite, primarily for Intel Sapphire Rapids processors tested in 2022. Intel apparently optimized their compiler specifically for the Spec CPU 2017 benchmark that's used to test high-end servers, data centers, and workstations, resulting in a 9% improvement that was not borne out in real-world testing. It's not the first time this has happened, but it is disappointing that Intel would feel the need to take such an action to attempt to boost the appeal of their server hardware. When asked for comment, AMD described the situation as an epic fail. Because AMD processors are called epic. You don't have to use that if you want to. Finally, we showed you pink strawberry-scented thermal paste last week, and apparently it looked so delicious that feasting on thermal paste and thermal pads is becoming a thing. Or at least it is for a Redditor who goes by Thegis_Peril, who posted over on the PC Master Race subreddit about fire ants milling about in their PC case, going into and out of their GTX 1060 video card. Disassembly revealed that the little buggers were actually chowing down on the card's memory thermal pads and the GPU's thermal paste, and they even returned for a second helping after Peril did a full alcohol cleaning and reassembly. Now, fire ants are already fearsome enough, what with their ability to breathe fire and all, so I think we should especially avoid scented paste or anything that makes our PC hardware more delicious looking. Thank goodness they're not going for the SSDs. I don't even know how you'd deal with that many bugs in your software. That was a bad joke, though. I like this actual joke on Reddit better. What is this? A computer for ants? Reddit always comes up with better jokes than I do. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button, leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.